Thank you for joining me today for Montclair Tabernacle's Adult Sunday School class. We've been talking about Christ in the book of Revelation. The title of our lesson today is The Second Coming of Christ. Central truth, Jesus Christ will return in victory over all evil. The overview, this lesson, we're going to talk about Jesus' return in the air. The great battle that will occur with his coming to the earth. And then the third thing, the consequences for those who oppose him. This study brings us to the climax of the book of Revelation. God's great plan reaches a critical point as the powers of earth make an attempt to resist heaven. This lesson ends with Satan being bound in the bottomless pit right before the thousand-year reign of Christ on earth begins, or the millennial reign of Christ begins. This lesson strongly emphasizes the victory of Christ over all evil, and his victory over evil can be our victory over evil. Okay, the outline, 3 points as usual. Christ returns triumphant. Second, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Third point, Christ's enemies are vanquished. Okay, the book of Revelation is an account of God's end time activity. Revelation 19 and 20 record the events that occur at the closing of this present age and then the introduction of the age of God's rule without the effects of sin or the consequences of sin. The enemies of God have blasphemed him and harassed the saints of God. The time has come to deal with Satan and his kingdom. Now, most Pentecostals and evangelicals have embraced the pre-tribulation rapture doctrine. In this view, this is the order of events. The rapture first, the return of Christ in the air to resurrect the dead in Christ and to rapture the church, the righteous saints. The tribulation begins, the 7 years of God's wrath begins after that. While this is going on earth, the marriage supper of the Lamb is taking place in heaven. Also, the seven seals are opened in heaven, which affects those on earth. The Antichrist rises during the tribulation. The battle of Armageddon is fought at the end of the tribulation when Christ returns to this earth. The thousand-year millennial reign of Christ takes place after this, then the great white throne judgment, and then, thank God, the new heaven and the new earth. What a great day that's going to be when Christ returns as he promised. All right, point one of the outline, Christ returns triumphant. We're looking at the scriptures from Revelation 19, 11 through 14. Revelation 19 is a prelude to the final judgment. Now we're going to talk about this glorious rider that enters. It's Jesus Christ in military mode and in military garments. John now sees in his vision the conclusion of the struggle between God and Satan, and the saints of God and the followers of the beast or the Antichrist headed by Satan. John saw heaven opened and a rider on a white horse. The rider came from heaven to do battle with the monsters on this earth, which are the beast or the Antichrist and his sidekick, the false prophet. Jesus comes at this time with a zeal for righteousness, not power. Okay, because all power has been given to him in heaven and in earth already. Matthew 28, 18. This rider had on his head many crowns. His eyes were like flames of fire, and he wore a robe that was dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God, which we know is Jesus Christ. A name was written on his forehead, and only he knew its meaning. Jesus is called the Faithful and True One. Truth is in short supply today. We don't even know what to believe. It's like there are so many lies, it's hard to tell between the truth and a lie. Isaiah 5 and 20 says, "Woe to them who call good evil and evil good, and those who call light darkness and darkness light, and those who call bitter sweet and sweet bitter." All right? The Bible says that God's word is settled in heaven forever, Psalm 119, 89. When Jesus comes, he is faithful and true. He is not going to change divine law for anyone. Divine law in his word condemns sin, and it will always be that way. All right, Jesus' return will be different from his first coming when he came as a baby in Bethlehem. He will come again as the warrior king. He will come again to judge and make war for righteousness, unlike the many rulers of this world whose wars have been unjust. The armies of heaven are going to come back with Christ at his return, and they also were riding white horses. This army wears some unusual clothing to go into battle. They wear fine, white, clean linen. There's no weapons and no armor found in this army. The rider that leads these armies will do all the fighting. His army will be witnesses and recipients of this great victory that he's going to win. John's vision of Jesus Christ coming to get rid of all the forces of evil has given comfort and hope to many who have been oppressed and persecuted in this world. This world will not remain forever under the curse of sin. Almost 2,000 years have passed, but we still believe the promise that he's going to come again and he's going to restore the whole creation back to its good original state. He's going to make all things new. All right? Christ returns triumphant. Second point, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Revelation 19, 15 through 18. Jesus is presented here as the warrior king. Guess what his weapon is? The word of God, which is the spoken word that comes out of his mouth. There's no military weapons. This sharp sword that goes out of his mouth is the spoken word of God. He is called King of Kings and Lord of Lords, a title that's inscribed on his robe and on his thigh. Christ is the king over every king who has ever ruled. All rulers, both human and spiritual, are subject to him. This rider, Jesus Christ, wears many crowns, for he rules over all kingdoms. And when he comes again, he will execute the wrath of Almighty God against the evil kingdoms of this world. John saw an angel standing in the sun, and this angel issued a very surprising call to battle. He calls for the vultures, the birds of the air, are invited to a great supper to devour the flesh of the enemies of Christ, who will soon be defeated. It should be clear to us, it is wise to be on the Lord's side in the battle between good and evil. The powers of evil are apparent and powerful on earth. Don't be intimidated or seduced by these powers. This is why the Holy Spirit gave this vision to John. The Lord wants us to know the truth about what is happening now and what is to come in the future. The doom of evil powers has already been determined by God. All right. First, we talked about Christ returns triumphant. The second point, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And now Christ's enemies vanquished. The great battle called Armageddon is what we're going to talk about here. Here we have John's description of the battle. The beast, or the Antichrist, and the kings of this earth and their armies are going to gather to fight against the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The Lord's enemies, or the Lamb's enemies, are dealt with quickly and without struggle. The end result is certain. Leading the opposition to the Lamb is going to be the unholy Trinity. That's the dragon, which is Satan, the beast, which is the Antichrist, and the false prophet, which is the Antichrist's sidekick during the tribulation. The beast and the false prophet are humans, which are totally given over to evil. The dragon who empowers them is Satan, the devil. The rider on the white horse comes from heaven with his armies, and the evil powers of this earth gather together to make war against him. The armies have gathered in response to the demonic summons from the evil, unholy Trinity. The first enemies to be defeated will be the beast and the false prophet. The beast, or the Antichrist, demands worship. The false prophet used demonic power to perform lying signs. The beast and the false prophet are captured and thrown alive into the lake of fire. Then the armies of the earth that oppose Christ face his judgment. At his word, they fall dead. That's all it takes. And their bodies are devoured by birds. They remain unburied, and the birds feast on the dead bodies, which is the ultimate shame. All right, Satan is bound, Revelation 21 and 2. Only the final member of the unholy Trinity remains. Okay? An angel descends from heaven, holding the key to the abyss, or the bottomless pit. And the angel has a great chain in his hand. Notice, this is not one of the big guns like Gabriel or Michael. This is just an angel. The angel seizes and binds that old serpent, Satan, the devil. Notice there are several names mentioned here. He doesn't want us to miss this. He wants to make sure that we know who is being bound by this single angel. This angel has a great chain in his hand, and he binds Satan. The angel casts Satan into the abyss, or the bottomless pit, and it is locked and sealed behind him. Satan can go no further than God allows. He cannot do more than God allows, and the time will come when Satan will answer to God. His future is sealed. Anytime, now or in the future, that Christ goes to war against his enemies, the outcome is certain. Christ will win. John's prophecy is as powerful today as it was over 2,000 years ago. All the powers that oppose God's kingdom are doomed to destruction. This should encourage us to remain faithful to Christ. We are on the winning side. This lesson sets before us a clear choice between life and death and good and evil. Here is what we know for sure. God will prevail over his enemies, and all creation is now and will always be subject to him. That's it for today. I'm excited what the future holds for God's people. I love you. I miss you. Goodbye for today.